to another flower arranging demonstration. My name is Sharon Dower. I'm from South Wales and I run a small flower school called Sharon Dower Floral Innovations, and I teach lots of workshops and classes, both floristry and flower arranging. Today I'm going to be looking at a very traditional design called the Hogarth Curve, or alternatively known as the Lazy S. Now, I've got a very basic metal stand, and I've chosen this because I wanted something that had quite a lot of height but wasn't too complicated. But it could be a vase or something similar that you might have at home. Lots of people just use a very tall, thin vase. Something plain and quite simple is better, and tall as you can get away with is ideal. This is one of those very adjustable metal stands that we quite often use in flower arranging or floristry. And my first sort of tip is to have a small piece of floral foam on its side, so it gives you quite a lot of height but doesn't give you too much depth. When your oasis is very fat, it means that you have a lot of floral foam to cover, therefore the centre of the design becomes very heavy and very bulky, and you quite often lose that very simple S shape that we're trying to create. So a tall container and a small piece of oasis, but something that has a little bit of height to it. And then foliage wise, I think the majority of people struggle with the Hogarth Curve because they pick the wrong choice of foliage and flower material to start with. You need to look for plant material, whether it's from the florist or whether it's from your garden. You need to look for things that naturally curve and naturally bend, and things that are quite pliable. For example, this is a piece of salal, and it's not very flexible. It doesn't bend very well without sort of snapping. So that's not good for manipulating into those curves that we need to create this design with. Now, if you've got access to garden plant material, you can have a look to see what you've got and what will curve and what will bend quite readily. But my first choice would be the florist foliage, which is called soft Ruscus. And I've got a few long pieces here to show you. And you can see with that it curves beautifully without too much effort, and without you having to do anything to it. They're curving very naturally, and if I just hold those sort of back to back, already we're creating that S shape without too much effort. So that's the Ruscus, the florist workshop Ruscus. I also have some Eucalyptus. Now, this is the very small leafed Eucalyptus morii, and again it already has a little bit of a curve to it. So straight away, I'm creating that Hogarth curve without making too much of an effort or too much fuss. And eucalyptus is quite pliable, so just by using the warmth of your hands, you can quite often manipulate it a little bit more so that it curves to a more degree and a bigger extent. So that's the eucalyptus. Now, what I've also done, you'll see that these are pieces of the Ruscus, so that's the florist foliage. And what I've done with that one is I've just bent it back on itself. You can sellotape it or you can tape it into place. I've just wrapped it round one another. I've done this for an hour or so, and you can see straight away how that encourages the curve to develop. And I'll show you this one as well. So I've just wrapped it round a couple of times, and straight away we have a much more curved piece of material to work with. That would also work brilliantly if you're trying to create a crescent shaped, inverted crescent, or an upright sort of crescent. So if we look back at the floral foam, I've secured that nicely in place, firmly with some pop tape around the floral foam, the plastic container, and the base of my container. That's nice and secure. If I just turn it around there for you, that's the front, and then the back is the section that you're going to be looking at initially. And then I'm going to start putting in my foliage placements initially to gauge the size and the shape of my design. Now, if you have a little bit of a think about what you're going to do in advance, my bottom section of my S, so I'm going to have a curve at the top coming down into this bottom section, I can't go any taller than that piece of foliage I've got there at the bottom. That's the maximum height I can do, and it's in proportion with my container. So what I did with that, because I'm then going to be repeating the shape on the top and the same length on the top, I've cut myself two lengths of identical Ruscus, and you can see if I can get the S shape going the right way, if I just hold that into place, you can see how that S shape comes together. Now, it doesn't matter whether your S is very sort of slimline, quite elegant, or whether your S is a little bit more pronounced and a little bit more curvy. This sort of style that I'm holding in my hand at the moment is very, very fashionable for wedding floristry, where we have these hand-tied bouquets where they're very uneven. We tend to call it a boho style, but it's exactly the same. You have that very lazy S-shaped movement coming from left to right. So if I just spin that round, so I can work at it from my side. So I have already cut this so that I know it's going to be the right size. And the reason that I wanted a tall piece of floral foam was because if the foam was short, then my piece of foliage would have to come in from the side, and then I lose straight away that elegant S shape. So by making my floral foam taller, it means I can come in at this sort of angle, using the height of the foam to its best ability, and I don't then lose that bottom half of what will eventually be my S shape. You can come towards the front of the floral foam a little bit more if you wish. It really depends on the plant material that you've got and the angle that you're trying to create. So that's the bottom section. And it's fairly equal top and bottom proportion wise. And this one will pop in quite nicely on the top, nice and firmly into the foam. And then already, hopefully, we've got a beautiful start to that very elegant S shape that I'm trying to create. And then I'm going to use little bits of the eucalyptus to join up with the Ruscus to make that S shape a little bit longer and a little bit wider at the sides. But keep it quite controlled. Don't go too tall or too wide with any of these pieces. Otherwise, you start straight away to lose that S shape. Now, the reason in the beginning I said to keep your floral foam quite thin is because if you imagine at this stage, we have to cover all that floral foam there in the centre. By the time we use lots of foliage to create focal point and to hide that floral foam, we're going to end up with a massed section in the middle, and straight away we would have lost that very elegant shape that we're trying to create. So small bits of foliage at the back. For two reasons: to hide your floral foam and to stop the floral foam from losing too much of its water source. If we leave big gaps at the back with floral foam showing, the water will evaporate much more quickly. If I just spin that round, you can see that it's not too flat at the back, so we've got some depth, and that will aid the balance. It'll stop my design falling forward, and it'll also create visual depth from the front of the arrangement. Now, right at the very front, I'm going to use some more of the Ruscus foliage, but this time I'm going to keep it quite short, and it's going to tuck in at the front here. Again, to hide my container, hide my Oasis tape that's holding the container on, but it's also being used as a link between the bottom part of my S and the top part of my S. So we don't want to have Ruscus just at the top and at the bottom. We need to have it moving through the middle of the design as well. Otherwise, as I described in one of the other videos, they look a little bit like two arms poking out on the side. So I've kept it very, very narrow in the centre. Still a little bit of faux hat showing, so we still need to add some more foliage in there. And I need to continue round on the sides here. But for a minute, I'm just going to keep adding materials, linking together the top half of my S and the bottom half, making use of these very soft, wispy bits of the eucalyptus now, top and bottom. I need a little bit of a long piece at the front so I can hide that tape. So again, even though I'm adding in more and more foliage, we haven't lost that very elegant look in the middle. It hasn't got too clumpy and too heavy. Now, as well as those longer pieces of foliage with the eucalyptus and the ruscus, I've also picked three large ivy leaves. So these are just your common old garden ivy. Three nice big pieces. And they're going to come in towards what will be our focal point in the centre there. It'll help to give the eye a place to rest. And it will also break up the very sort of fussiness of the two types of foliage. So the eucalyptus is small and thin, and also the ruscus is quite small and thin. So by introducing those big, bolder ivy leaves, it gives a contrast in texture, a contrast in colour, and stops that very fussy, frilly look of the two types of foliage that we've got. So I'll just fill in for a minute with some plant material, and then we'll spin it back round for you to see how that's coming together. So even though I've put in quite a large amount of foliage, it's not too bulky, it's kept very small and very compact. And as I said in the beginning, if you'd have had a huge piece of floral foam there, we would have got very, very heavy here, and we would have lost the outline shape. Now I happen to have some of another florist foliage. This one is leatherleaf, very versatile plant material. I've got quite a lot of this at the moment in the studio, so I'm just going to use this to fill in and cover any little bits on the sides or the back of my arrangement. And liking the way that's coming together. Now, even though this is seen as quite a traditional, maybe a little bit of an old-fashioned design, it is so beautiful. I mean, it's done correctly, it's such an elegant design. Okay, so now my flower choice for this one is this lovely, very pale or apricot-y sort of peach carnation. And I've picked the carnation mainly because you can quite often find carnations that will have a little bit of bend or curve in the stem. They're not as rigid as a rose might be. So carnations or spray carnations, they're quite often very good for this design. And I think I've got seven. So we're looking to follow now that outline shape that I've created with the foliage with our flowers. Now I always stress that if you create your outline shape properly, if you spend time getting your outline shape correct, whether it's a triangle or a posy, or in this case the Hogarth curve, if you get that shape correct first, let's find the one that's a little bit more bendy, then the flowers will naturally follow on to the shape that you've created. Buying for this design is definitely all about buying the right materials, buying flowers and foliages that will bend slightly. So what I've done now, I've just put my outer two placements in, so my bottom and they are roughly the same sort of length. Your eye will pick up on the foliage, and then it will pick up on the flowers, and it will bring you through the centre and back out, finishing down on that little point there at the end of the foliage. Now, for beginners, I would suggest at this point you would put your focal flower in, which would be roughly in the middle and just above where we put those three large ivy berries there in the centre. When you get more proficient and you get used to creating a Hogarth curve, you can naturally place in your flowers as you come down. But for beginners, I try to do a little bit of a sort of dot to dot sort of system where you fill in the gaps. And it makes it a lot easier when you're learning to evenly space out your plant material. So I've created a lovely outline shape. That now gives me a really nice guide to where my flower content is going to go. If we just spin it round, you can see the top section very beautifully coming down, almost like a little serpentine there, sliding down. And then we repeat that on the opposite side, trying to keep the placement of the flowers fairly equal. Now, if you had a choice, your focal flower, which is this one here, would be your largest flower. But in my case, all my flowers are fairly similar. So we've got a focal point with three below and three above. And hopefully the gap in between each placement is fairly similar. It doesn't have to be identical. And then to strengthen my sort of focal area and give me a little bit of transitional material, I have the very pretty brunia berries, and I just happened to find one that had that lovely curve on it. So I'm on a winner before I start. And that could go quite high. Now this could be broom, there's lots of broom around at the moment. You might have it in the garden, or you can certainly buy it in supermarkets. You might even find that pussy willow that you get when it's fresh will bend quite well, so you might even get the curved shapes with the pussy willow. And just like I did with the carnations, I'm just following that lazy S outline shape that we've created all the way back down, spending a little bit of time looking at each piece of material to see where it will best sit. Now this one again has a slight bit of a curve on it, so this would be great at the bottom section. And then the pieces that are more rigid and straighter would be best placed in the centre part of the design. Now we've used repetition to make your eye move from one part of the design to the other. So repeating the colour, repeating the shapes, helps us to create a design that's very pleasing for the eye. So just turn that round and see how you can see that coming together. What do you think of that one? It's actually one of my favourite designs. A lot of people struggle with the Hogarth curve, and I can't stress enough, it really is about picking the right materials. Now this is a little bit of willow. This is the plant material that's growing not far away from my unit, and straight away in its natural environment it will be hanging down from the tree, so again it has that lovely curve. So we can add that in as another plant material, and then if I use these ones at the base, that helps to carry the colour and the texture through to the bottom. And they're beautifully long, so they come right to the end of my Ruscus pieces. And then more shorter pieces towards the centre, so we don't lose the outline shape. And we don't make the design too heavy and too visually clumpy there in the middle. Now if you don't have any transitional material or anything that will give these lovely curved shapes. Just stick to adding a little bit more foliage in. Spray carnations, which are readily available at the supermarket. Spray carnations are brilliant for this design because they have a natural curve to them as well. Spray roses aren't too bad, although sometimes they can be a little bit stiff. Now I've just got a little bit of container showing, so we'll grab a little bit of the longer pieces of the Ruscus just to knit in under there, because from the front I've got a little bit of plastic container showing. Now, depending on what way the camera is angled, you might be looking up at it so that you might be able to see from the camera view more of the plastic container than I can. But when we take a proper photo of it later, you'll be able to see it from the angle that I